So, earthquake, which is a tragedy to life and property. We will go through a PPT on earthquake and also types of seismic waves. For that, I will show you a small video as well. Okay? Earthquake contribute to be one of the worst natural hazard. So those occur naturally. They are inevitable. That is, they are bound to occur beyond our control. So they are actually the natural hazards. But when that earthquake happens and when the damage is done to life, property, everything, then it is called the natural disaster. Correct? So earthquake constitute one of the worst natural hazard which often turn into disaster, causing widespread destruction and loss to human life. The effects of earthquake vary upon the magnitude and intensity. Amount of magnitude and amount of intensity that determines the damage caused by the earthquake. Correct? So earthquake occur every now and then all around the world, except in some places where earthquakes occur rarely. So our globally, as well as if you talk about our country also, it is divided into different zones. Depending upon the intensity or vulnerability of earthquake happening over those places. So that also we will see further. So some are called the earthquake prone areas, some are called the less earthquake prone areas. So depending upon that, the effect or the frequency of the earthquake could be observed in those areas. The devastation of cities and towns is one of the effects of earthquake, major effect. So what is an earthquake actually? An earthquake is a result of a sudden release of energy in the earth's crust that creates seismic waves. Some sudden release of energy from the earth's crust, which leads to formation of the seismic waves. And when the seismic waves reach the surface, okay, so that leads to formation of the earthquake. The seismic activity of an area refers to the frequency, type, and size of earthquake experience over a period of time. Basically, we will go through a video which shows types of seismic waves and how they travel. Depending upon that, then you find out how the type of earthquake is. Depending upon the magnitude and intensity of those seismic waves, you determine how much the damage, or we can say the effect of earthquake is. Okay. For example, a very small example, simple example, I mean, if you throw a stone in a pond of still water, series of waves are produced on the surface of water. This spread out in all the directions from the point where the stone strikes the water. Correct? If you strike a stone in the water, you can see from that particular point, series of waves will be created. Similar is the thing that happens in the earthquake. That is, similarly, any sudden disturbance in the earth's crust, sudden disturbance, like you throw a stone in the water, likewise, if there is a sudden disturbance in the earth's crust, it may produce vibration in all the in the crust, which travel in all the direction from that point of disturbance. So very easy to understand from this simple example. A single point of disturbance from where the whole disturbance in the form of waves travels in all the point in all the direction from that point of disturbance. Correct? So there are certain terms that are related to earthquake that you should know. Now, first term is the focus, okay, which is also called the hypocenter. So focus is the point on the fault where rupture occurs and the location from which the seismic waves are released. Like you throw a stone here and from where the waves are generated, so it becomes the focus, the focal point. Similarly, the point from where the waves are generated, that is called the focus. Now, focus is a point on fault. Now, what happens is our earth's crust is divided into different planes. Okay, how does the earth takes its shape? How the shape changes, and I mean not changes, but how it is forming a particular shape? It is because the earth's crust, the whole land, the whole outer covering is made of different planes. Okay, and these planes are joined together, and the line between those two planes is called the fault line. Okay, like you, whenever you talk about earthquake or read about earthquake, you must have read about tectonic plates. What are those tectonic plates? The same thing what I'm talking, that the earth is made up of different planes. Okay, and these planes are joined together and they form the shape of the earth. Now these planes come together and the line between them, the point of junction between them is called the fault line. Okay, so those planes are actually called the tectonic plates. Okay, so when they are together, the point of junction, that line is called the fault line. Okay, so if in further PPT I will show you these tectonic plates, they are not strict, nothing. They are joined, they slide against each other, which is a natural phenomena. But if this sliding occurs at a higher rate, sliding of the tectonic plates is a common phenomena. Okay, so sliding of these planes is a common phenomena because they are close to each other. So obviously they are going to somewhat slide against each other. But when this sliding occurs to a greater extent, that leads to the vibration, because that is what is earth made of. Earth's crust is made of tectonic plates, correct? So if that sliding occurs higher, at a higher rate, okay, then it leads to this formation of earthquake, that is the formation of this vibration. So on that fault line is the focus point from where the seismic waves are released, okay? Then epicenter is a point on the earth's surface that is directly above the focus. So you see here, this is suppose two planes and this is the fault line between these two planes. This is the focus point where actually you can see this arrow. This arrow means these two planes are sliding against each other. But suppose that sliding is at a higher rate, at some point which is called the focus point, from there you could see this orange waves generated. So these seismic waves are generated, and the point exactly above the focus point on the ground is called the epicenter. Okay, so the point where an earthquake or underground explosion originates. Okay, then the fault line. A fault line is the surface trace of a fault. So this is the fault line. Okay, the line of intersection between the earth surface. Okay, the two planes of the earth surface where they join each other, that is called the fault line. Okay, that particular line is called the fault line. Fault plane are the cracks or the sudden slip of the land. Okay, sudden slip or sudden crack, okay, or that particular line is that fault plane. Then fault scarp is the topographic expression of faulting attributed to the displacement of the land surface by movement of the fault. See here, if you could see here, here it is written as fault scarp. Now what is that fault scarp? When, as I told you, that along the fault line the two planes slide against each other, okay, and if that sliding is higher and it is causing a disturbance over the land above, okay, and making some formation of that land, okay, so that is called the fault scarp. So that is the topographic expression. So wherever you see a valley, wherever you see mountain areas, wherever, whatever the topographic topography you see over the land, that is because of the underneath phenomena that is going on. So if along this fault line, okay, so if there is some displacement of the land above it, it will lead to formation of some topographic region, okay, that is called the fault scarp, which is formed because of the fault between the two planes and the movement of that two planes against that fault. Okay, then what are the major causes of earthquake? So the primary cause of an earthquake is fault on the earth's crust of the earth. So as I told you, earth's crust, where you have this tectonic plates, or you say the different planes which are joined together, and the line between them, I mean the point of junction between them, is called the fault. Okay, so the major cause of the earthquake is the fault. A fault is a break or fracture between two blocks of rocks in response to stress. So a line, it is not a complete block. The earth's crust is not a complete solid block. It is made up of blocks of rocks or planes of rocks, okay? And the junction or the fracture between them, okay? That is called the fault, okay? So this movement may occur rapidly. So which movement? The movement between the two blocks of rock forming the earth's crust, or the movement between these two tectonic plates, okay? The movement may occur rapidly in the form of earthquake, or may occur slowly in the form of creep. Creep in the sense moving very slowly. So naturally, actually, this earth crust, which is made up of blocks of rocks or tectonic plates, they move very slowly and therefore does not cause any disturbance on the earth. But if they occur to move very rapidly, so they will lead to formation of the earthquake. Okay. Earth scientists use the angle of the fault with respect to the surface, that is known as the dip, and the direction of the slip along the fault to classify the fault. So there are classification of faults as well. So depending upon the angle of the fault, depending upon the direction of slip of that land, okay, so there is classification of faults as well. Now, so major causes of earthquake on the basis of its causes are surface causes, volcanic causes, and tectonic causes. Okay, so these are the three major causes. Of course, primary cause is the fault, and three major causes because of which earthquake can occur is the surface causes, volcanic causes, and the tectonic causes. The surface cause is the great explosion, landslide, slips on steep coast, dashing of the sea waves, avalanche, railway trains, heavy trucks, some large engineering projects cause minor tremors. Some of them are man-made and other are natural. Okay, so any activity that is happening on the surface of the land, and therefore because of which the tremors are created all over the land, okay, so that is called the surface causes. Of course, they are not that major, but yes, minor tremors like earthquake are caused, and they are actually not earthquake, but they are because of the surface causes. Like in the first lecture itself, I had given you an example of some south city, that how because of some explosion, the earthquake earthquake was felt in that particular area, but then it was found that it is because of some explosive, a truck carrying explosive, and that explosion that occurred, and because of that the tremors were felt in that particular city. So that is the surface cause. So same way, if there is some great explosion in a particular area and the vibrations you feel in your area, so that is surface cause. So great explosion, which can be man-made, landslide, which are natural, correct? Slips on steep coast, dashing of sea waves. Now, dashing of sea waves is also natural. Avalanche is a natural phenomena. Because of this phenomena, also, when you feel this vibration, minor tremors, earthquake-like feeling, so those are the surface causes, okay? Because of the railway trains, heavy trucks, you feel the vibrations in particular area, some large engineering projects are going on, okay? So because of that, when you feel the minor tremors, those are the surface causes, okay? Then volcanic causes. So volcano, in further lectures we will also go through volcano, because it is also one of the natural disaster, correct, which is there in your syllabus as well. So volcanic cause, that is volcanic eruption. In short, volcanic eruptions produce earthquake. Earthquake may precede, accompany, and frequently follow volcanic eruptions. So wherever there are volcanic eruptions, you might see that in the start, it might happen that in the start, the earthquake is felt, and then which has led to volcanic eruption later. Or volcanic eruption and the earthquake are occurring together, or following the volcanic eruption, the earthquake is felt in that particular area. Okay, so those two phenomena actually go hand in hand, because those two phenomena are commonly related to the Earth's crust, the volcanic eruption or the earthquake. Both are commonly related to the Earth's crust, correct? So, they are caused by sudden displacement of lava. I mean, the volcanoes are caused by sudden displacement of lava within or beneath the Earth's crust, correct? So, you see here in this particular picture, the lava which gets erupted, and if you see here the cracks like thing shown, so they are actually the waves that will lead to earthquake. Okay, so there are two general categories of earthquakes that can occur at a volcano: volcano tectonic earthquake and long period earthquake. So that is when happens volcanic volcano and earthquake when happens together, that is called the volcano tectonic earthquakes. And long period earthquakes after volcano eruption, when earthquake occurs for a longer time, that is called the long period earthquake. Okay, so that is one of the cause, volcanic cause. So first was the surface cause, then the volcanic cause, and then the major, that is tectonic cause. Structural disturbances resulting in the parts of lithosphere is the main cause of this type of earthquake. Most of the disastrous earthquakes belong to this category and occur in the areas of great faults and fractures. Suddenly, a sudden yielding of the strain produced on the crocks of accumulating stress causes displacement, especially along the old fault zones known as the great transform faults. So that is what I was talking about, the tectonic plates. That is the fault line between the two tectonic plates. They are sliding against each other, but when this sliding, when the displacement is too much against each other, lot of energy is released, which leads to formation of the earthquake. Then how is the strength of the earthquake measured? The intensity and strength of an earthquake is measured on Richter scale. You might be knowing about it. The scale invented by Charles Richter, California, USA, in 1935, which categorized the earthquake on the basis of energy released. Okay, so Richter scale is a scale which measures the intensity and the strength of the earthquake. According to the values on the Richter scale, the earthquake is then categorized, okay, into different levels, or the areas are categorized into different zones. Okay. So, what is the definition? That is, the logarithm to base 10 of the maximum seismic wave amplitude recorded on a standard seismograph at a distance of 100 kilometers from the earthquake epicenter. So, now you know what is epicenter, correct? So, this Richter scale is nothing but the logarithm to the base 10, okay, log to the base 10, of the maximum seismic wave amplitude, okay, so that magnitude of that seismic wave recorded on a standard seismograph. So you now know that the amplitude of the seismic wave is recorded on a seismograph at a distance of 100 kilometer from the earthquake epicenter. So when you know the epicenter, okay, like whenever an earthquake occurs, first of all, what we ask is the epicenter. Because epicenter, as you know, from the focus point directly to the directly above the ground, that point will be affected majorly, and that is called the epicenter of that particular area. Okay, so this at the measurement is at a distance of 100 kilometer from the earthquake epicenter. Scientists measure the strength of the earthquake using the machines known as the seismographs. And seismology is the scientific study of earthquake and propagation of the elastic waves through the earth. Okay, so now you know seismology is study of the earthquake and the propagation of the waves. Seismograph are the instrument that is used to measure the strength of the earthquake. Okay, how the measurement is done? It is done on the Richter scale, and the waves are called the seismic waves. Okay. Then, now you see here, the group and the magnitude. Okay, so whenever we heard about or we hear about an earthquake occurring in an area, we are known about the magnitude. So depending upon that magnitude, immediately from this table, you should be able to classify whether it is a major earthquake, a strong earthquake, or it is a minor, very minor earthquake. Okay. So when the magnitude is 8 and higher, it is the great earthquake. 7 to 7.9, it is the major earthquake. 6 to 6.9, it is the strong earthquake. 5 to 5.9, moderate. 4 to 4.9, light. 3 to 3.9, minor. And less than 3 is very minor. Okay, very small tremors that are felt. Okay, so this is how. Now, immediately when you know an earthquake has occurred in a particular area and you know the magnitude, immediately you can say whether it is a minor, moderate, strong, major, great earthquake. Okay. Now, amount of energy released during different earthquakes. Okay. So now you have seen here the classification depending upon the magnitude. So intensity of the earthquake, which is measured on the Richter scale from 1 to 8, what does that intensity actually mean? So that intensity, how intense the earthquake is, that intensity actually mean amount of energy that is released from that earthquake. Okay, so when the intensity is 1, amount of energy released is 170 grams. Similarly for 2, it is 6 kilograms. 3, it is 179 kilograms. For 4, it is 5 metric tons. 5, it is 179 metric tons. For 6 intensity, it is 5643 metric tons. For 7, it is 179100 metric tons. For 7.5, it is 1 megaton. And for 8, it is 564300 metric tons. Now, what this mean? See, if you see the amount of TNT, in the sense, energy release is this much amount, but how to compare that energy with the intensity for that amount of TNT. Now, what is TNT? See here, I have written trinitrotoluene. Okay, trinitrotoluene is a yellow odorless solid that does not occur naturally in the environment. It is commonly known as TNT, and it is an explosive used in military shells, bombs, grenades, industrial uses, underwater blasting. Okay. So that energy is compared with TNT. Okay, so when you talk about 170 gram, so what is that? 170 gram of TNT, the energy that will be released from 170 gram of TNT, that energy will be 1 point on intensity of earthquake. Understood? So what do you mean by 6 kilogram of energy? So 6 kilogram of energy release means 6 kilogram of TNT will release the energy which will be equal to 2 intensity of earthquake. Okay, so that comparison is given. Then, seismometer, the measurement of earthquake. Okay, seismometer are instruments that measure the motions of the ground, including those of seismic waves generated by earthquakes, volcanic eruption, and other seismic sources. Now, just a second. Here you see seismograph. Okay, so the instrument that is used is seismometer, which gives you the seismographs. See, seismometer may be deployed at the earth's surface in shallow vaults. Okay, a small opening, enclosed opening is there. An opening but which is enclosed completely. Okay, so there the seismometers could be installed in boreholes or underwater where it is cased, that is enclosed underground. Okay, and there this seismometer can be installed to measure the motion of the ground. Then, now types of zone. Now depending upon the magnitude of the earthquake, okay, area is divided into different zones. Okay, so earthquake zoning map of India divides India into 4 seismic zones based on the observations of the affected area due to earthquake India, due to earthquake in India, which is divided into four type of zones. That is zone 2, this is said to be the least active seismic zone. Zone 3, it is included in the moderate seismic zone. Zone 4, considered to be the high seismic zone. And zone 5, it is the highest seismic zone. Okay, so our country is divided into zone 2, 3, 4, 5. Zone 1 in the sense it is not at all active for seismic activity. Okay, so zone 2, 3, 4, 5, this way these zones are done in the our country is divided into these zones depending upon the magnitude of the earthquake. Proceed. Okay, so based on the past seismic history, Bureau of Indian Standards grouped the country into four seismic zones, and all these four zones, out of which zone 5 is the most seismic active region, where zone 2 is the least. So you can see here, zone 2, low intensity zone, magnitude is 6 or less. Zone 3, moderate intensity zone, 7 or less. Zone 4, 8, and zone 5, that is 9 and above. Okay, so this way it is divided, 6, 7, 8, 9. As you know, from here you could have seen 6, 7, 8, and 9. The rest of the earthquake, the magnitude, are the lighter, minor. Okay, so they are the lesser ones. So 6 or less, that is 6 and below. So basically it is this one actually, 5 to 5.9 and the 6. So moderate to light, minor, very minor, this is one zone, and the rest are the other three zones. Okay, zone 2 and the rest 3, that is zone 3, 4 and 5. Okay, 9 and above is the highest one. So now you can see here, and you can locate your area as well, where the earthquake occurred in Bhuj. You can see here, it comes to zone 4. Correct? Our area would say Mumbai, it comes to zone 3. Correct? Zone 1, there is no seismic activity in these areas. Zone 2, less seismic activity, moderate, high, and very high. Okay? So you can see how our country is divided into different zones depending upon the magnitude of the earthquake. Okay? Then earthquake prediction. Earthquake prediction is usually defined as a specification of the time, location, and magnitude of a future earthquake within stated limits. If some prediction could be done, okay, forecasting could be done of the time, location, and magnitude of future earthquake, that is called the earthquake prediction. Some evidence of upcoming earthquake are as follows: when there is some unusual animal behavior, when there is some disturbance in the water level in the well, when there is large scale fluctuation of oil flow from oil wells, when there is foreshocks or minor shocks before major earthquake, when there is sudden temperature change, when you could experience uplifting of the earth's surface, change in the seismic wave velocity. So these are certain phenomena which can help in earthquake prediction. Now seismic waves are actually measured, as I just told you, seismometer, they keep on measuring. But when there is sudden change in the seismic wave velocity, so that also can give you a prediction of earthquake. And similarly, some certain more phenomena which can give you a prediction of whether the earthquake might occur in that particular area. Then effect of earthquake, you know it, that it is loss of life and property, damage to the whole transport system, be it road, railway, highway, airport, marine. damage to infrastructure, chances of floods, develop cracks in dams, chances of the fire short circuit, communications such as telephone wires are damaged, water pipes, sewers are disrupted, economic activities like agriculture, industry, trade, transport are severely affected. So these are the major effects of earthquake. Continuing to the effect of the earthquake also leads to landslides, correct? It also leads to shaking and ground rupture. It might also lead to fire. For example, if there is any short circuiting, it can lead to fire as well. It can lead to soil liquefaction wherever the soil is semi-saturated or saturated. Okay, because of this vibration, the soil will flow away like it flows like a liquid. So that way, that is called the soil liquefaction. The earthquake can lead to tsunamis as well when there is disturbance underwater. So you can see here the fault line and disturbance, which also leads to formation of tsunami waves. Earthquake also leads to vibrations. Of course, when there is tsunami, of course, because of the earthquake, when there is high tide, it is going to lead to floods as well. Certain simple earthquake safety rules that if you are in house, don't use lift for getting down from building. Be prepared to move with your family. Okay. Of course, you shouldn't use lift because the earthquake which is happening, it's going to affect the all electrical connection, all everything. So you don't, please, don't risk yourself by using lift. If you are in shop, school or office, don't run for an exit. Take cover under a desk or table because earthquake is a phenomena like I'm telling you from last time that it happens for few seconds or few minutes. Till the time you reach the exit, you might get affected. So don't run for an exit. Since it is going to happen for few seconds or for few minutes, for those that particular time, you don't have time to run away from where you are sitting. It is very difficult unless and until you are living just near to land, say a ground floor very near to an open space. But if that's not the condition, like if you're in shop, school or office, take cover under a desk or table. Why desk or table you should take a cover on? Because the vibrations which are then going to lead to damage of the structure, it might happen that structure might fall on you and you might get affected. So better to save yourself from some cover and table which are strong tapes, which are strong temporarily, at least for that time being, it can save you. So whenever there is this hard structure, okay, like a table where you can take cover under, okay, and save yourself for that particular time period. Move away from window glass because they are going to break. Do not go near electric point and cable. Keep away from big portion of the building and false ceiling. Correct? Electric point and cable, they are going to get damaged. Short circuiting might occur. So do not go near that. Weak portion, you know your building. You're staying in a building, you know what is the weak, where are the weak portions of the building. So don't go near to that weak portion and don't stand below the false ceiling because it is during the vibrations, during the earthquake, it is very easy for false ceiling to break down. So don't even stand near a false ceiling. If you are outside, okay, if you are outside, avoid high buildings, walls, power lines and other objects that could fall and create block. Okay, do not stand near buildings, walls, power lines. Don't run through the streets. Okay, just now I shown you a photo. It causes rupture or cracks on land. Do not run through the streets. If possible, move to an open area away from the hazard, including trees. Not even stand near the trees because vibrations under the ground, they are going to make the trees as well to fall. So just move to an open area if possible. If you are in vehicle, if suppose you are in vehicle and earthquake occurs, Stop in a safe and open place. Do not stand near a building. Do not stand near the. Do not keep your vehicle standing below a tree or near the electric pole or something like that that is easy to fall down. Stop in safe, open place. Remain inside the vehicle. Remain inside the vehicle and close the window, doors and vents. Okay. Then after this is what we are seeing when the earthquake occurs. After an earthquake, what precautions you should take is keep calm, switch on the transistor radio or TV if possible, or the mobile phone, wherever you could hear the news. So switch on the transistor radio and obey the instructions. Keep away from beaches and low banks of river. A huge wave may sweep in. Okay, looking for an open space, do not go to a beach because of the earthquake, a huge wave may sweep in. Not re-enter badly damaged building and do not go near the damaged structure. Turn off the water, gas and electricity supply. Do not smoke, light match or use a cigarette lighter because short circuiting might happen. You might not even know. Do not turn on the switches. There may be gas leak or short circuit. If there is any fire, try to put it out or call the fire brigade. Do not drink water from open containers without having examined it. If you are aware of people who have been buried, tell the rescue team, do not rush and try to worsen the situation. Call the rescue team. Do not go by yourself, go and rush and get yourself in danger. Avoid places where there are loose electric wires and do not come in contact with any metal object. Eat something, you will be better and more capable of helping others. Do not walk around the streets to see what is happening. Keep the streets clear so rescue vehicles can access the road easily. Okay, so a few of the precautions that you should follow after, that is following the earthquake. Few of the earthquakes, the major earthquake, that is September 2, 1993, the Latur earthquake, 6.3 magnitude. Now you know, depending upon the magnitude, how you can classify the earthquake. Okay, damage is large areas of Maharashtra, rock, 10,000 people lost life. Then May 22, 1997, the earthquake which happened in Maharashtra of 6 magnitude, 40 people were killed and over 100 were injured. 29 March 1999, Nandaprayag, which is in Uttarakhand, 6.8 scale, widespread destruction in Chamoli, Rudraprayag and other areas, massive loss of human life. Then January 26, 2001, very famous, the Bhuj earthquake, Gujarat, of magnitude. So you can see the magnitude, such higher magnitude, 7.8. The tremors left by India and neighboring countries, over 1 lakh people were killed, huge loss to property and infrastructure. October 8, 2005, Muzaffarabad in Pakistan occupied Kashmir, 7.4. Now, why this? Because the tremors were felt in India as well. Heavy damage to life and property, death toll with about 1 lakh in Pakistan and nearly 2,000 in India. So, nearby country, the vibrations were felt in the country, our country as well, leading to death of around 2,000 people in India. So this is the picture of search and rescue phase of Latur earthquake 1993. 1993 we are just seeing 6.3 magnitude. So you see the damage occurred. It's like some demolition done. Okay, but this is what had happened naturally because of earthquake. People being trapped under the debris. Disaster picture from Kashmir earthquake 2005. Then, the very famous Bhuj earthquake, on which the movie has also come, right? So, earthquake, one case study in very small way we would see, that is Bhuj earthquake, which has occurred on 26 January 2001, which is what we could say is not that old. So, I don't know whether you people might be very small at that time. So, I don't know whether you might have experienced this, since it happened in Gujarat, but certain vibrations were felt, certain tremors were felt in Maharashtra area as well. I myself had experienced certain vibrations when I was in my school. In 2001, when I was also in school, we felt very, very, very low vibrations, but we do felt that. So it was of so such a high intensity that even the vibrations were felt in Maharashtra. Okay, so 26 January 2001, the origin line is, I mean, the timing 8:46 in the morning, 42.9 second. Epicenter, exact latitude is given 23.40 north and longitude 70.28 east. Magnitude around 7.7-7.8, and focal depth from where it generated, that is focal depth 25 kilometer. So Bhuj, you see where it is, correct, in Gujarat. On the morning, like I said, it was in the morning of January 26, 2001, the nation's 52nd Republic Day, a devastating earthquake occurred in the Kutch district of the state of Gujarat. The earthquake was felt as far away as Delhi in the north and Kolkata in the east. Bhuj town and the village Bachao, 60 kilometers east of Bhuj, were the worst affected, and many other areas of Gujarat, including its state headquarters, Ahmedabad, were badly affected. Damage assessment, there were more than 20,000 deaths and 1,67,000 people injured. Four districts of Gujarat lay in ruin, and altogether 21 districts were affected. Four districts were completely lost and 21 districts were affected. Around 3 lakh families and at least 3 million children under 14 age were affected. Around 6 lakh people were left homeless. In the city of Bhuj, more than 3,000 population of the city lost their lives. The main hospital was crushed and close to 90% of the building were destroyed. 90% of the building. So in that comes all the infrastructure, the hospital buildings as well. There was significant damage to infrastructure with facilities such as hospitals, schools, electric power, water system, bridges, roads that were damaged and destroyed. Damage to high-rise building in Bhuj. If this is the condition of a high-rise building, imagine what would be the condition of people living in normal houses. Then, local response. The response within India was immediate. The national and state government quickly provided assistance in many forms, including cash, medical supplies, communications, teams, shelter, food, clothing, transport, and relief workers, which is actually needed. All the countries, all the state governments come together to help. There were more than 185 NGOs, mostly Indian charities, which undertook earthquake-related activities. We got a huge response from international countries as well. Search and rescue teams soon arrived from Switzerland, UK, Russia, Turkey to find and rescue survivors buried under debris. So we have international agencies, international organizations. Whenever an earthquake occurs in a particular country, the other international countries also come together in help. Okay. Relief teams and supplies soon followed from 38 countries as well as United Nations agencies and many international NGOs such as the Red Cross. The World Bank and the Asian Development Bank sanctioned loans in less than 3 months after the earthquake because huge economic loss. Correct. Relief and reconstruction. So the Gujarat Earthquake Emergency Reconstruction Project, GEERP, was started by GSDMA, that is Gujarat State Disaster Management Authority, with financial help from World Bank, Asian Development Bank, Government of India, and other donor agencies. Several state governments came forward to participate in the reconstruction work in different villages. The United Nations system the multilateral and bilateral agencies, multilateral in the sense various international countries with, when they are together, that is called the multilateral agency. Bilateral, when two countries are together forming an agency, that is called the bilateral agencies. NGOs and the corporate sector participated in the relief and reconstruction work. So to tell you about all this is that earthquake was of such a huge effect, such a huge disaster, I mean, that so much help and so much immediate response was required. Government of Gujarat provided assistance in the form of material and cash to around 218,000 families. NGOs supplemented the efforts by providing shelter to about 7,000 families. About 65 NGOs were active in the Kutch alone, who adopted 211 villages and constructed around 32,297 houses at the cost of 185.80 crores. The technical support was made available to owners who were provided loan to reconstruct the houses. So this was about the Bhuj earthquake. That very small review about the Bhuj earthquake, that how bad the disaster was, how the intensity of 7.8 has affected the whole state so much. Some major earthquakes of the world are shown. Okay, the points are shown of some major earthquake that has occurred in the world. So we will stop our lecture here. Just a second, huh? Okay, so as I told you, I will be showing you a video which is on type of seismic waves. Very small video, it is 2 minutes hardly. Exactly, we will end the lecture at 10:15. So just give me a second just.
The motion we feel on the surface of the earth during an earthquake comes from energy released deep within the earth. This energy is transmitted to the surface by earthquake waves. The study of earthquakes and earthquake waves is called seismology. Earthquakes occur when rocks deep underground suddenly break under pressure or slip along a fault. The point of release is known as the focus of the earthquake. The energy released by the earthquake radiates from the focus as body waves. There are two types of body waves. The fastest wave is called a P wave, or primary wave. It moves between 4 to 7 kilometers per second, depending on the density of the rock it's moving through. A P wave is a compression type wave. Rocky material in its direction of travel compresses, then expands as the wave passes. A P wave is similar to a wave traveling through a spring. The coils compress and expand in the direction the wave is traveling. The second type of body wave is called an S wave, or secondary wave. It travels at about 2 to 5 kilometers per second through rock, about half the speed of a P wave. An S wave is a transverse shear wave. Rocky material in its path moves up and down or side to side, perpendicular to the direction of the wave's travel. An S wave is similar to a wave traveling along a piece of rope. The wave moves along the rope by moving a section of the rope up, then down. Surface waves radiate outward from the epicenter, the point on the surface closest to the focus. Surface waves are slower than body waves. traveling at 2 to 3 kilometers per second. They can change the surface of the Earth, as well as damage homes, buildings, and other structures. There are two types of surface waves. A love wave causes side-to-side motion perpendicular to its direction of travel. It can cause damage by breaking roads and pipes. The second type of surface wave is called a Rayleigh wave. It moves the surface of the Earth up, forward, down, and back in a circle. It can cause damage by knocking buildings off their foundations. In most earthquakes, combinations of love and Rayleigh waves cause the most destruction because the ground shakes up and down and side to side at the same time.